their wins, they're getting just a million kills and closing out very, very slowly. But also when they lose, they tend to actually fight pretty close, right? They're fighting team fights pretty well. When Energy lose, they mostly roll over, right? You looked at Froggen's scoreline where he had, it was like 19-4 or something on Friday.
Yeah, 18-4.
18-4, right? And then Energy's 0-2, they got 5 total kills. It's like, well, that's going to make your scoreline a bit worse.
Yeah, and it's because Echo Fox mostly play slow. That's the big thing, is they don't give up a lot of kills. They're actually quite good during the early parts of the game. The game just snowballs, and they seed objectives, and they'll give up the turrets when they're behind. And then that makes it so that the other team gets ahead. They aren't taking a lot of risks or counter pushing or having these team fights when they're not prepared for them.
Yeah. Some of the issues that Echo Fox is not doing almost much at all, really, and they're just kind of hoping they can get themselves into the team fights. The Froggen can carry them, and we'll see if these teams get better over time. Continued trend of target bans, and again, I think this is fine as long as you are able to play the horse trading game afterwards and get your matchups correctly, because you're moving one set of options and hoping you can pick properly for the rest. No Vladimir allowed for KFO, but you're noticing, right, no Ryze ban, no Azir ban even required, because you're probably not going to see them played by Echo Fox anyway. And there's the Cassiopeia, right?
Yeah, that's the one.
There's 3 mid lane bans, and outside of Vladimir, they're almost only for Froggen there. Here we go. Okay, the Ryze does come through. That's actually something at least. Echo Fox bringing out one of the more high-tier picks. You'd consider it traded for Azir normally, but we'll see if Energy even wants to go for that kind of play.
Yeah, and GBM, I believe I talked about it yesterday as well. He doesn't play a whole lot of Azir. He's been favoring things like the Victor over it. He's been playing even Ziggs.
Mm-hmm.
So it hasn't been his go-to champion in almost any regards, and he picks up the Karma, which he ended up playing yesterday.
Right.
Not to great effect at all, though, because he's a big carry for the team, but there wasn't really anybody to enable on that squad.
Absolutely true. He was kind of the only one doing any damage. That didn't mean very much for them. Santorin tried on Graves, but they just didn't get far enough ahead, really. Next few picks coming through, and looks like Echo Fox, once again, going for plenty of utility in the lanes that aren't Froggen's right now. The Gragas for hard, and the Jhin actually out of Keith. Not rushing to get any more high-tier picks, though, right? That Azir, again, left on the table as champions that tend to be very, very common. But as Energy have grabbed themselves the early Rek'Sai, I mean, at least they are playing the pick rate game right now. They're auctioning off the top tiers. So I can't really give them too many major complaints. Both these squads looking to give their top lane pick for later, which honestly makes a lot of sense. KFO and Kwas each could take over the game based on the sort of current pool of popular top laners.
It's true. See if anybody adopted the Shen that's been so popular lately.
Right.
Aurelia still on the table.
Mm-hmm.
Swain still up for Kwas.
Jax.
True.
Okay, so this is time around, right? We're seeing Victor, at least it's number 4 as far as the mid lane pool goes, but I think it's a lot better, though. You're putting GBM on a damage dealing mage, a strong laner as well to boot. Karma support, I think, one of the very, very best right now. At some point, I expect to see her nerfed, to be honest. I think she gets even better in 613, by the way, so we'll probably see her go even up in priority. And so far, I think Energy actually have a reasonable draft for themselves. And I want to see what Echo Fox actually pull the comp together with, because unless they have someone to set up for the Jhin, I mean, yeah, he can ult for slows, maybe that's enough, but it's still a bit of a reach.
Yeah. I think you go either Braum or Nami here for your support, and then for your mid laner, looks like it's Twisted Fate. Okay.
Okay.
Don't even have to guess.
Ryze into the top lane. That's going to be the matchup there. Looking for the blind pick, Ryze top lane. I like this. TF in the mid lane. Plenty of playmaking tools. Froggen, actually quite a good Twisted Fate player as well. I think this is a nice lineup for Echo Fox.
Yeah, it actually, what I was saying, and their mid laner, because I actually did assume that the Ryze was going top.
They
showed the Victor, and you're just going to pick something that can wave clear against it early on. Ryze kind of gets shoved in.
And immediately push him out.
Yeah, and the Twisted Fate, I think, is a really good pick here, not just for the composition, but for Froggen, because Froggen likes to affect the other lanes, and he likes to spill his lead over. Remember when he's playing things like Lissandra, he had the engage tools, and that's where we saw Echo Fox seeing success. Putting him on Twisted Fate gives him a lot of that power for picking.
Definitely agree. So we'll see if that can line up. And I definitely, if I'm ever playing Jhin or Nami, I would love to have a hard CC setup for my skill shot route afterwards. The W is easy for Jhin, the bubble's free for Nami.
Oh.
Last pick comes through as a Maokai, actually. That was all Kwas was playing in the very opening weeks of the games. And he's back on it here. Maokai and Ryze, it's great gank assist, right? You've got a Rek'Sai who's got good CC and decent damage early game. Maokai in the same boat, and they can certainly target KFO with this kind of a lineup. It'll make him a little bit harder to gank as well. The Maokai's pretty tanky, and it rounds in a tank to the lineup.
Yeah, but the Maokai Rise matchup is a little interesting. Like, sure, Maokai does get a lot of sap magic.
Yeah.
But it's still so much damage from Rise that you're forced to build the magic resistance route very early on. So you don't get your Sunfire Cape. Your Iceborne Gauntlet isn't really...
Yeah, you'll get pushed in.
All the way up there.
You will get pushed in. At least you can mirror teleports. But the nice thing is, like, Jhin's not the best tank buster, so a magic resist stacking Maokai kind of can't die in this game. It's four magic damage dealers.
It depends if he goes the penetration build.
True, yeah. I guess it depends what he goes for here, but... generally speaking, yeah, I think Maokai can definitely be successful here as the coaches shake hands. We get ourselves into this one, and at least this draft looked a lot more normal. So could be a good sign for both these teams. So we're going to get ourselves into the first game of the match. You guys can help us along by getting on Twitter and calling out your predictions for this one. For Echo Fox, use hashtag FOXWin. For Energy Esports, hashtag NRGWin. And let us know which squad's going to come out on top here in game one. Both these teams looking desperately for a way out of the bottom of the pack right now. They're sitting several matches now behind Counter Logic Gaming and Apex, who are more comfortably over in 7th and 6th. And getting out of the promotion tournament zone would be nice for these guys. If Fox can find their second win, Energy could maybe find their third. It'd be a good start to the back half of the split.
Yeah, both of these teams, 8th place, 9th place at the moment, trying to get up there and catch CLG, because I believe there's two games between them.
Yeah, two matches.
And the next one's up. So you have to start picking up these wins and separating yourself from that bottom if you really want to get up there and into playoffs. Because both of these teams had playoff aspirations, right? Energy.
Yeah.
That Energy against right there on the monitor.
I know. It's so easy to read phonetics.
I know. It's Energy.
Yes.
Even though it's never spelt that way.
I know.
It's regardless.
They did their thing.
Regardless. They blew up their roster, and they built around GBM, and they had aspirations to go to playoffs and do well because they made it last time, and they didn't do very well against Liquid. Fox, on the other hand, they also were like, okay, we didn't play a lot of the split. They looked really good by the end. In spring, they want to make playoffs as well.
Sure.
So they want to pick up wins here. Both teams are going to fight tooth and nail, because one of them has to win. That's how it works.
One of them has to win. We are here in North America where we never have ties. It's just kind of how we do our sports here. And the crowd is ready to go. We are ready to go into game one of this matchup. They are Echo Fox taking on Energy Esports. And I really do think this will be a very good match, a very competitive one. And I really think it might be quite telling. Energy's games were super disappointing yesterday, but that was either because Energy has gotten worse or CLG's finally good. Echo Fox, we know that they can hang with some of the good teams. They took a game off TSM, took a game off Envy.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they can finally make this work. It's like the new potential team here, Echo Fox.
They took a game off of Cloud9 as well on Echo Fox's side.
But they come so close.
Yeah, but Energy, on the other hand, you know, they've taken a game off of Immortals in Envy. So they've also had single game victories that haven't impacted the standings for them. So these two teams have shown those bright spots, those glimmers of hope. It's just putting it all together. The game is a lot about teamwork right now and macro play, but you have to have that individual level down as well.
Yeah.
And so both teams are kind of struggling with that aspect where they have skill, they just need to be able to perform consistently and then get the teamwork down. Because I saw these guys losing tier 2 turrets in a lane swap yesterday for almost no reason.
I absolutely agree. And well, as we get into this one, and this is the first rematch I'm actually now casting in the summer split here. And the first time around, Energy took down Echo Fox, and it was a 2-0. Now, tiebreakers in North American LCS actually go primarily to head-to-head. Game score is actually secondary to your head-to-head match if you're two-way tied. So Energy right now owns the tiebreaker. Mm. And if, let's say Apex crumbles, for example, these guys are actually fighting for like 7th versus 8th, or they go even higher and they're fighting for 6th versus 7th, and Energy owns the tiebreak, well, that's going to push Echo Fox down, not to mention, of course, the fact that they would lose the match in the first place. And so Echo Fox coming back and winning the series would help them tremendously in making a late season push and getting into a better spot. As we are in a lane swap game, we saw KFO try to absorb some of the experience. Quas doing the same. Quas actually got a little bit more experience overall right now as he's sitting pretty comfortably under his turret. KFO roaming, tags KiwiKid, but doesn't get a whole lot done. And I wonder actually when Energy will reinforce their AD carry, because pretty soon they should be pushing this turret down. And there's a teleport in from Quas. He makes sure the minion can tank those three extra turret shots. And KiwiKid comes up. So Energy definitely have looked pretty good in their lane swaps, right? You're seeing Quas. He walks down to the lane. He absorbs. KiwiKid tries to harass. And then he joins his AD carry when it's time to push the turret down. looks to make a play otherwise. Froggen pushed around a little bit by GBM. It actually looks like GBM has access to more minion kills right now, so we might see at the end of the third wave a higher farm total for the energy mid laner.
And the lane swaps for both teams have been back and forth in the way that they've played them. And I've been seeing something consistently, though, from Fox, is once again, Big does not invade the jungle level one. The blue buff gets taken away on the strong side of the map for them. And so they get triple buffed at the start. This actually happens so much to Echo Fox that it's rather surprising because they're doing the Krugs level one. They're not getting the lane swap wards down. So they're doing the Krugs just in case, and then Big doesn't run over and try to interrupt the blue, because you'll do the blue buff second, right?
Mm-hmm.
They have time to get there and interrupt it, and that's exactly what Kiwi Kid did on the Karma. Pushed Ryze out of lane, went there, hard had to stop doing the blue buff.
Yep, Centauran gets a fresh one. Also, what's interesting is the way Energy played the lane swap, I can tell they've really focused on this, and I'm going to assume it's Hermit doing a lot of the legwork for them. They knocked the turret down a wave early, actually, as Hard takes some of his own jungle back. But it meant that Kwass got one more wave, basically. It meant that he got a wave that normally OQ slash Keith would have taken, as they killed it like right about 3 minutes, left the whole wave untouched. And this meant that now Kwass is ahead. If he ever matches up against KFO, he should be a wave of minions ahead of gold and experience over that Ryze. And if it's a matchup that Energy want to tilt, right, target a squishy Ryze in a long lane, they've already set Kwass up for that with the small lead he's got right now.
A decent part of that as well is the fact that...
Oh, no.
Oh,
ooh, wow. Timely flash. The root wasn't lined up in time. The rune prison actually did not last long enough to let the rest of that CC come through.
This is actually a big sacrifice, though. First off, to jump off of your point,
yeah.
Kwass, he used his TP to get there, and that's one of the reasons that he has this type of lead. But also, it's just going to get bigger now because he has this wave pushing towards him, and this just happened where you have three members on the bottom side. For the top laner, the AD carry and support of Fox are all on that bottom side against Kwass, or sorry, against OQ. Kwass is still top alone, farming. The wave is frozen pushing towards him. You can't go farm that wave if you're KFO. So now Kwass is going to keep amounting this lead, and that's a big problem because that turret is already down bottom. Yeah. I don't know why you have your AD carry and support down there. They tried to go for a cheese.
Yeah, they went for a cheesy play, and I can't hate on that, right? Like, they were 0.09 seconds away, or some, there's actually a real number, I'm sure, I don't know what it is, from that being a first blood, and like immediately it's worth it, right? Immediately that risk is worth it because, well, here's 600 gold into the team, we're way more ahead than that three minion waves was worth, bam, we get to win the game here off this one. And you know, I will always respect plays like that. I love when teams find those innovations, when they start realizing, oh, everyone's being really, what's the word, complacent. Everyone knows the lane swaps work, so everyone's gonna do the same thing, and you start cutting corners. Right, as the metagame pushes forward and people do the same things, you start finding corners to cut. And then you start trying to find ways to abuse those cut corners and make them bleed for that one. Unfortunately, Echo Fox didn't quite get it.
Yeah, the other thing is Kiwi Kid's like not here as well, right? So that wasn't a move that they could have punished. They couldn't have their support show up, help the AD carry, and now Keith gets to thin out the wave, and they get to play 2-on-2 if he does show up. So Fox looks like they just went for the lane swap and then swapped it back to have standard lanes after they tried for that play.
Okay, well, we're going to see if they can make that happen. By the way, I want to mention what happened in the pause. I believe there's supposed to be no flash photography in the battle theater, and someone was doing it. So we paused to say, hey, please cut that out. Don't distract the players. Thanks very much. And we're back into this one. So not a technical issue, but audience issue. Shame. We're okay. So, small gold lead for Energy because the gank play by Echo Fox did not pay off. KFO is actually pushed out of lane entirely. He's still not farming. He's level 3 to Kwass's level 5. And that is where the lead is right now.
Yeah.
4x the minion farm for Energy's top laner.
They kind of shafted him because bottom, they put their AD carry down there. They put Keith down there. So Keith gets a little bit of a farm advantage because there's a gigantic minion wave that's pushing towards him. But KFO gets nothing.
I mean, I imagine if that play had worked, all of Echo Fox would have just shoved that wave into the tier 2 turret, reset the waves, come back into it. But yeah,
it could have been big because Kiwi Kid's on the opposite side of the map too.
Yeah, it could have been massive. Unfortunately, Big himself couldn't land the bubble in time, and Keith couldn't land the root, and you know that's really unfortunate stuff for them. But yeah, the reaction was a little bit slow. They're getting some of the gold back right now, and we'll see as it pays forward because you also see that Keith is ahead on Oki right now, and Some of that is OQ getting one less wave. Keep in mind, that's 7 minions that Quas got that OQ didn't. Then OQ got ganked, was forced to, like, recall again, and, you know, he's in a really weird spot.
Delays his call as well.
Yeah.
Oh,
and here's the first snap of the play. There's
level
the gold
two.
Card, into the root, into the damage up, and Kubik gets spent so long. Roman, he doesn't even have a health bar left. 300 HP, another ghost into the gold card, into the first blood. Nice play right there. And a great pickup now for Echo Fox. The second game I've seen now, Kubik could delay his own level substantially.
Yeah, he delayed it, and he was able to go top lane, come back down bottom, and he got nothing. That's what happens when you deviate. The lane swap is the way it is for a reason in play at the highest levels, and you watch it. Because it works, and because you don't end up sacrificing things like this and having that happen. So he doesn't have his root. There's no way for him to stop Froggen getting closer to him. Gold card goes off again. He's got Q and E.
Yep.
And that's it. So he can't W him right here. Can't get the root off and create more distance.
Right, a Mantra W would save his life for sure. He'd heal for like 300 HP. Now KFO though in the long lane. The matchup energy wanted in the first place, and now you're seeing that pay off. So both these teams actually able to utilize what they drafted in champ select. Okay, they don't necessarily play all the meta stuff. We're not seeing an Azir this game. Okay, fine, but nice to see them find a strategy and actually make these things work. We are seeing like proactive choices and smart play by both these teams.
And I like this because we're talking about how they drafted. The Maokai is something we do not see right now on 612.
Yeah, very rarely.
At all. And Ryze, very easy to gank. Low mobility, especially pre-6. Santorin, on the Rek'Sai, this is a classic combo from last season. Maokai Rek'Sai, every time. Go
yep.
gank.
Everyone knows this matchup there. That's pretty standard
Point
stuff in 2015,
win.
2016. Yeah. Point and click roots, not too bad. Well, bounce around, the energy continue to have the gold lead for themselves because they're still up in the farm game right now as Santorin continues to play with a perfect KDA 0-0-1, only padding his own stats, and up quite a lot of farm over hard. So OQ shoves that bottom wave in, and it likely won't be a freeze. Very rarely will you see a marksman in a support freeze down here, so there's Keith thinning the wave out rapidly. This time a blue buff does go over to Frog in the first one of the game for Echo Fox as Santorin had taken both. Round one of the lane swap. Again, OQ really being left alone frequently.
Yeah, he can't walk forward, though. There's that ward in the middle of the lane, and that could be TP'd on by KFO.
Yeah, and some of that, I actually wonder if Echo Fox wanted to freeze anyway. If Kiwi gets unwilling to lane, OQ does not gain experience, and he's just zoned out entirely. The reason you generally push because you want to fight for things like this Ocean Drake, but they could actually force Kiwi Kid to walk back down and shove in, but either way, the waves are cleared back and forth, but keep in mind, Keith got priority on that wave. Boss pushed in. They can fight for this Drake. We'll see if it happens. Ulti coming across. A little bit of damage on a Quas. Big, oh, way too far up. He did not expect there to be a Maokai. That's a silly mistake. And Big goes down. Honestly, a big mispositioning. At this point, on a gifted kill to energy, and that should be the Ocean Drake.
It literally was big mispositioning.
Yeah, it was.
So, Quas able to point and click. TP back up at the top lane. KFO can't really do anything about this. He wasn't able to TP in either. And he catches the wave. That's perfect for him.
And this is the funny thing, is sometimes you just need to make a reasonably aggressive play and you invite misplay. Like this there were mistakes made by Echo Fox in that defense entirely, but Energy just simply saying, hey, shove the wave out, walk the Maokai down. Just bread and butter League of Legends gameplay, you know, coordinated standard play. And well, Big screwed up, KFO didn't push in time. Guess we got a kill on a dragon.
Yeah, and also they abused their level advantage. They had Quas at level 6, he had his ultimate if a fight did break out, and KFO was shoving desperately to try and get his level 6, and it put him
Yeah. Rough stuff right here. So you're seeing Energy now sitting nicely at an 800 gold lead and an Ocean Drake early game, which is great for them. As Keith just says, yeah, top lane's gonna be for our teammate KFO, taxing as much of the jungle as he can to try to catch up in this game as he's sadly, two levels underneath. Quas, a great knowledge of how far you can leash the Gromp till it starts losing patience. It's close to the tri-brush, as you can see there. If he brought it much farther, it would have started leashing back rapidly.
Yeah, and now he'll freeze this.
He should, yeah. Nothing to fight for. You probably will end up giving, in the next minute and a half, the Rift Herald to Energy because of how much KFO's not going to fight, but that's fine for them.
Yeah. Hard, looking for a play here. Froggen not in position, though. Froggen's not even playing to the side. There's five members of Energy down here.
And this is a weird play, because Quas without teleport and against a frozen lane is actually joining his dual lane to make a tower dive. But KFO has his teleport, and he has his ultimate up very soon as well, so he can match this dive. We're seeing an attempt right now, but TF and Ryze could show. Here's the attempt going in. Hard knocked away one, but look at the burst damage. Big is gone already, and Hard's too low to do anything about this. O2 takes him down. Two quick kills for energy, and looks like there won't be a collapse really at all. Yeah, and looking for three. Keith gonna get slowed down by a sapling chase. No, it actually won't aggro onto him, but he's got nowhere to go. That'll be the kill picked up. So now, what can Echo Fox get for this time? And it will be Froggen pushing in the mid wave. The rest of the team unable to collapse. And, well, energy, again, showing some good forward thinking. Oh, top lane wave is frozen. Five-man dive. Make it happen. GBM shoving Froggen. Get there first. They did it.
Yeah, Froggen walked up to the left. I think he was going to ward in the river, that one that's on that banana bush. And it put him outside of range of actually using his ultimate. GBM had roamed, and Energy had pink ward control of the mid lane. You can see they have one on the right and one on the top left. So Fox are actually kind of blind on those sides. They didn't know if GBM was just roaming and walking there, or if he was going to go off to the side and wait for Froggen to show himself. But yeah, Froggen has to wait for the wave, goes up to the left to ward, and he's caught unawares. And they just dive with five members here. And oh boy.
Oh boy, indeed. Froggen right on top of Quas. Gold card lands. And this Maokai's running out of teammates rapidly. He's gone. Now no one on that side of the map. Nice go picked up for Echo Fox. And Froggen now two ultimates, two kills. Nothing else, though, is happening for Echo Fox. It's only those. It's the only good things. When Froggen shows up, things happen.
You can see he's going for the Lich Bane now as well. Has the Abyssal Scepter completed.
This is the PvP build. He is trying desperately to kill champions and drag his team kicking and screaming into a couple of wins here. Bit of wave clear by Hard. I think he actually hit his Q late. The ulti actually hit it first, but that will keep the turret alive for now. Energy landing some poke, and otherwise he's walking away.
Losing
2,000 gold
jungle,
difference.
Though.
Sorry?
He's losing his jungle, though, at the same time.
Yeah, he is.
Santorin has control of that.
And, you know, Santorin is a stellar player, so immediately identifying what's going around on the map. Oh, Hard's somewhere visible. Okay, let me walk in and find some camps. Gets that done. More clear on the mid wave. A nice bubble in the barrel gets rid of some more of the minions. OQ with the Karma Shield gets a bit more done. Dodged away from the deadly flourish of Keith's Djinn.
And so,
what's up?
Finally, KFO actually ahead in CS because Quas was bottom, ended up dying, loses out on
right,
CS.
Yeah.
Now the question is, does he go top to defend or does he go bottom now because his TP is almost up and catch this wave because he needs to get back up there in CS.
Yeah.
And the reason that Energy were able to make these plays at the beginning of the game is because Quas was so far ahead, and that gave them the confidence to do so. It's like, oh, he's two levels up, 100%. Let's go for Ocean Drake. If they fight us, then they're going to lose.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the mentality behind that. And now that Quas is now even with KFO, and Santorin's actually pretty far ahead of Hard, by the way.
And I have honestly been nothing but impressed by Energy's lane swap games in all three they've played so far this week. They're two against CLG. I think they won the lane swap against Counterlogic Gaming. They made some really nice plays. There are some really good things coming out here. And this play right here where they donate extra farm to Quas and then find ways to use him to push a further lead, all really good things. And now, with a nice lead, they're actually out-macroing Echo Fox quite well. And some of these, yes, the mistakes by the blue side, but at least we're seeing a proactive team trying to make plays. And these are really heartening things for a team that's 2-7.
Exactly. It gives them a lot of hope for this series, but also for the future when they go up against teams higher in the standings,
sure,
that they can actually hang with the big boys, because so far, they haven't been able to take a series off of those top teams.
We'll see if they can finally move up there. I'm looking at their next week's games. I'm curious then if Energy keeps playing this well.
They get
Apex and Cloud9, which honestly at this point seem like slightly more beatable teams for them. And well, it was a story for Echo Fox last split, the late split surge, but maybe this is the story for Energy if they keep playing this well. 3,000 gold to lead for them, and KFO has support coming in, quite literally, as there's a Nami right behind him, and four in the top lane for Echo Fox as they try to get themselves back into this one.
And I love the way the Energy are moving around this map, especially Santorin. But this is bad because OQ is not there.
With five, looking for the play, and it's just a bunch of tanks. They get onto Santorin. Finally, explosive cast, bit more damage, but KFO has a flash away from the turret, and Quas takes down Frog, and finally, the four-man dive does not pay off. They could only hit tanks who were too durable to die, and Energy withstand it all. And it's a four magic damage team. You've got a Spirit Visage and double Mercury Treads.
They're gonna keep
going.
Lo and
behold.
Quas has flash root. They're bringing Santorin to the bot side, but it's still Kiwi Kid with a speed up. And they're going to keep chasing them so that they can get the inside track on mid.
Okay, yeah, inside track on mid is the play. Plus, Santorin looking to solo the Cloud Drake. And Cloud Drake actually one of the hardest ones to solo. No, he's actually going to get over the wall. Just kidding. He's going to join the mid lane after all. And it will be half a mid lane turret down.
That was really, really good by Energy, though, because Kiwi Kid could have kept shielding GBM and getting GBM closer to the left side and maybe even pick up another kill. Mm-hmm. But instead, they're like, no, the turret damage is worth more. I like that move. Yeah. Definitely priorities in the right place here for Energy.
I think we're honestly seeing a lot of smart choices by Energy in a row right here. And they can easily collapse onto the right-hand side of the map and take that Cloud Drake after all. I know Hermit loves to complain about how often Energy get Cloud Drake.
Complain or?
I mean, wrongfully complain. As we all know, Cloud Drake is actually the best.
Now it's just a meme.
I know. It's great.
Still.
You see, yeah, they try to focus down Santorin. Fox
KFO just misses a whole bunch
there.
He's like,
there. Throws Q's at Kiwi Kid for no reason.
And they miss, and then GBM comes across. Quas pops his ultimate for that final
Froggen
bit of damage right
aggro.
Before he ends up flashing. And KFO dropped the turret aggro, and it went on to Froggen.
Yeah.
Quick thinking there by Quas as well to root the person who got aggro.
Absolutely. And, you know, good by him to knock down Froggen here. So we're seeing Energy continue to react appropriately to Echo Fox's game. And that's the first Destiny we've seen actually backfire from Froggen here. He was otherwise the only good thing on Echo Fox right now. And even that's slightly falling away.
That was basically a 3-on-5 that turned into a 4-on-5. OQ never showed up to that. And mostly because of Quas and Santorin, and the fact that they're so tanky right now, it just took them forever to even do anything in that tower dive. You're tower diving two tanks.
Yep.
And you barely have any items. Like, tank item efficiency at this point in the game is actually still really good compared to one damage item.
Yeah. And smart are these players to actually buy the right things, by the way. I know you mentioned in champs, like oh, delaying Sunfire sucks. Like, I don't care.
Yeah.
You're just 4 AP, get a fist, get a vintage, get another cowl, be invincible.
Yeah.
And look at that.
And Keith is going for the crit build as well, so I think it's okay. Actually even better.
Mm.
The penetration build.
Because he's not flat penning.
Exactly. He's not flat penning, which is worth a whole lot when they aren't
when
building
you don't
anything.
Don't buy any, exactly.
Basically, Maokai's a squishy at that point.
True damage to Maokai sounds fun.
but. Regardless, he'd have a lot of HP anyway. I do want to touch on Santorin because I loved his positioning around where the action is happening. Because he still has 100% kill participation, only person on his team to have that, and he's going for that 007 again. He's done that so much. I can't think of how many times I've had to say like Santorin 007 in a game.
He's very good at not dying. He's a very safe player, but still manages to be in a lot of the action.
He's joking in the lobby. He's a KDA player.
Oh, he's a blue buff stealing player as well.
Yeah.
Doesn't affect KDA.
Yeah.
Feels good.
Might affect the KDA of his mid laner, because definitely gives him a leg up there over Froggen. Like, you just want to take that away. You want to get that away from the mid laner. You want to give your own a little bit of an edge, and we are seeing that so much this season, and I'm absolutely loving it when I watch it, not when it happens to me.
Yeah. Because you're a jungler, so if you're ever playing against Santorin, you're probably losing that game.
Well, my mid laner's losing it. It's his fault. He didn't secure it.
He didn't last hit the blue buff. So it's all about him. Ooh. Well, bottom lane turret gonna get dropped. Energy completely out-rotating Echo Fox.
Yeah.
Getting the boss out of the map, smashing it entirely.
Well, they see that Froggen's topside. He doesn't have his Lich Bane completed yet. He could go back and get it. He just has the Sheen, so he's trying to knock down a tier 2 turret, and that's gonna be Energy engaging.
Root in on the hard. The damage coming out of the Jhin not meaning a lot to Kiwi Kid. Root hits Quas from her time, but this time now, Santorin a bit overextended, takes plenty of turret damage, but is able to walk away safely. Top lane still being pushed in, by the way, by Twisted Fate as Energy remains on this side of the map, looking for plenty of damage output. Oh, forcing the flash of the KFO and killing the turret. And this team isn't dying, by the way.
Froggen's finally back.
They just refuse to take damage. They're so tanky, it doesn't even freaking matter. They face tanked an inhibitor turret for like 20 seconds in the face of Echo Fox.
Froggen wants to go, but if you go in as Twisted
going
Fate,
mid lane.
Okay, good. Yeah, he saw that they all just kind of bunched up instead of taking different routes. If they had, they would have been picked off. But if Froggen jumps in there, Victor just puts down the gravity field, pretty much guarantees that it's going to lock up Froggen.
Echo Fox do so little damage right now. At least they're able to answer back. And actually, gold-wise, two turrets for two turrets, pretty much equal. It actually doesn't matter what one you get. I forget what inhib turrets are worth. I know outer and tier one, or tier one and tier two are worth 800.
Mm-hmm.
I forget for tier three.
And
no kills, so
I think
like,
we equalized all of them.
I just don't remember if that stayed 800. Mm. I just don't remember. Either way, it's very, very close, and there were no kills. Certainly, the types of turrets taken are worth more. Energy have an open inhib in the bot lane. Obviously, that's better. But the gold stays pretty close to equal here as we're sitting just over 3,000 apart. It's a winnable gold deficit, but Energy are showing they're playing better.
Yeah, you were talking about mid laners 1v5ing. Froggen literally just got two turrets by himself.
Yeah. Well, he was 1v0, though. His team was 4v5.
But still,
either way, it's Froggen causing the situation.
Basically, I'm talking about the map movements
of
other utilizing Froggen.
Yes.
His ultimate, he's the only person who has kills on his team. He's used his destinies to get those, and he's the one who also used his destiny to get that turret and also the split push. There's a reason that energy was in the bottom lane. It was because of Froggen, but Froggen was able to kind of equalize that scenario because of the turret takes.
Mm-hmm.
And this is going to become even harder for Fox in the future because their composition looks like it wants to 1-3-1. It doesn't have like great wave clear without Froggen. It kind of looks like it wants to 4-1. But Energy just want to flat fight you. They want team fight. They want to group up on an objective. They want to get to Baron. They want to have the choke points. They just want to brawl. And it's
and
so Fox easy to do that.
Pretty much. Like, he needs to finish his Zeal item. Okay, he's out.
You got to bail.
Yep. He's good.
And now he's like, team, like, get something. They're all coming here, and they don't get anything except for inside track onto Infernal, which could be important. But like
they can get wards first, and that's it.
Yeah. Like I said, it's hard for them to team fight here because of Quas.
Right. Somehow, Keith has to break through that, and that's not going to happen. Quas, 84 armor, actually.
Yeah.
Without buying an armor item, and 2,500 HP. Keith is not going to break through that with an Essence Reaver and a Zeal. That's just not going to happen right now.
Is that base armor, or does he have...
He's probably got the mastery, because I think I saw his armor go up when people were near him.
He just bought the armor, too.
Yeah. Some of that's base. I forget where all of it's coming from.
Yeah, he's also got Rift Herald buff, so taking a little bit less damage.
If he's alone, yeah.
If he's alone.
Energy looking for the play. Echo Fox did manage to get themselves on top of the dragon, and they took down Infernal Trick, which is nice for them, but Energy making the quick play, but they're on top of Vision. This will not go well for them. I can't imagine it really succeeding. KiwiKid chunks dangerously low, puts in a late shield, which means basically nothing. Still actually manages to get tagged by a wild card, just fails to dodge that one. And Quas is now on to Keith, the only man who can even deal damage to him. Nice tunnel wipe to disengage. And yes, this is Echo Fox buying some time, landing the root, and just walking away. KFO is split pushing. He never TP'd in. That was a Drake taken and a Baron stopped 4v5. And Echo Fox finally getting something to munch on, getting something under their way. Gold lead now below 3,000. Couple more minions knocked down, a little bit of turret damage. Maybe they claw a little bit closer in. This Kiwi also is going to pick himself up an Aegis, go towards Locket. This is a team with a ton of MR. Keith himself actually still has 400 gold to go until he finishes a rapid fire cannon or a static ship or something. So his damage output still a bit lackluster. Boss probably goes towards, I would actually guess, Sunfire Guardian Angel as his choices. Deadbands wouldn't be too bad either. He doesn't really need to specialize in tanking. Like, I don't think he needs Randuin's to do his job. So
yeah.
Something more utility focused to let him do his other jobs better.
I think he goes Iceborne Gauntlet.
Wow.
I think so.
That would be aggressive.
I think it's a great item for catching this composition and having those team fights. You can peel for your Victor. You can keep Keith in one spot, Twisted Fate in one spot. Like, nobody has a move block on this team that's a carry on Fox.
Yeah.
Like, that's what I would think. But
sure.
Quas
yeah,
could just
that.
Be like Thornmail and done. But there you go.
Well, it's that or Frozen Heart.
It might be. I wouldn't buy Frozen Heart.
I wouldn't buy Frozen Heart against this team.
So.
Yeah, yeah. I think you made the complete right call, Zyrene. You crushed me in item game right there, because that was a great idea.
I played a lot of Maokai.
You do play a lot of Maokai, actually. You're right about that one. KiwiKid getting chunked out. He's going to live, though, this one. Quas gets a TP in and out big. Once again, knocked up, just destroyed by Santorin and GBM. The two of them taken down, and Big turns into Sushi. He never even tried to flash or ult away. And now, once again, the attempt at Baron Hard is around. Jeez, a pickoff by Froggen. His third kill of the game. The supports just pray for everybody.
Yeah.
Baron actually knocks up two of energy, and now these squishes in the backline taking a lot of punishment. OQ has to jump away. The root's going to not actually put GBM in the ground.
Yeah, their damage dealers are too low. Energy's damage dealers are below half HP. So both OQ and GBM, it's too risky to continue that Baron. It's the right move to pull off of it.
Yeah.
And they lost their own support, so.
Mm-hmm.
These supports, it's a brutal game for these guys.
Oh, sure. I was given the confirmation by production. Thank you guys backstage. He is running Legendary Guardian, which is the armor and MR for people near you mastery.
I'm also interested if he's running armor per level, because normally you run
HP
per level.
Normally run health per level, and I think he should as well, but.
But it's just a.
I think you would have more armor at this point if it were. I'm not sure though.
Looking around.
Yeah, so he shield flashed, and then Froggen's like, nah, I'm just going to ghost in and get this one. Because he watched that initial pick. And Froggen really just kites it away quite nicely, right? Forces a TP out, but Big just chases in, not... Like, thing is, Froggen used Destiny, right? Everyone should have known where energy was, and Big still managed to walk into four people. Well, three, I guess, but... And then, yeah, just the flash. I just feel bad.
It's the return, like, gank.
That's not Kiwi Kid's fault, really. Big, I think, honestly, has made some very substantial mistakes this game. But...
Yeah.
Yeah, that one's not on Kiwi Kid quite so much. That's just Froggen being vindictive.
Yeah. A lot of the Echo Fox problems have been stemming from the jungle and support and the way that they're controlling the map.
Yeah.
Because they give up a lot of kills, and it doesn't allow Froggen to operate. And here we go. See what they can do in this fight.
5,000 health
Froggen's
on Baron.
Not there.
Hard is around, and he has the ulti to knock away people if he wants to. There's the root, not quite going to get KFO all the way. He flashes away from the Karma. Once again, onto the Baron, still at half HP, 5,500 on that one. And it's still energy taking a lot of punishment. Froggen is actually just still chilling in the mid lane, wave clearing. He's actually playing this time properly. His energy aren't doing
perfect
damage anymore. KFO and the rest of Echo Fox are playing these Baron baits exceptionally well. Massive props to them for very good play by these guys. And Energy are having, just like in the CLG set, massive problems after 20 minutes.
So Froggen, he ran through the turret and he was like 1/10 HP in the mid lane. So he wasn't even a big threat to jump in. But after 20 minutes, you're right. It just, Energy, some of their problems are a little bit coming back up in this game, despite having a lead. That lead hasn't been expanding. It's actually been closing. They're up a turret. They're up
right.
Four kills, and it's a 1,400 gold lead.
And some of that is disingenuous because Twisted Fate generates free gold by being a champion. So, like, gold as an indicator of success is a little bit weird. But Froggen getting cut out. What a great engage. Quas finds him with a flash root, a wonderful pickup. And now it's a 5v4. Once again, Jhin ulti coming across. Keep looking for that curtain call, looking to stop this Baron attempt. KFO and Hard waiting around. Big is here with his ultimate not quite up. No tidal wave here. That curtain call didn't do all that much damage. The tanks are still durable.
Baron is slow.
Damage on the Kiwi Kid. Yeah, they're trying to slowly break it down as OQ does a bit more, but plenty of armor on him. Running away from the traps, once again back onto Baron, gets some more AoE down. These guys are losing a lot of their armor and magic resist, and now it's up to Hard to try to find the steal. Santorin has been a great smiter all split long. He disengages, and Hard's in the wrong spot now. They've got to try to make this play. Explosive cast could disengage them. Can he get him out of this one? He's just taking a whole ton of damage. Can he get him over the wall? Hard pops the ulti. Oh, it's picked up there by Santorin. Hard old Slate goes down too quickly, never even got to cast his smite.
Doesn't smite.
I think he could have secured that one, honestly.
It's 92.
An earlier explosive cask, I think, actually would have gotten that for him. Either way, though, yes, Santorin secures it. Two more kills for Energy, so make that three in a row now, plus the Baron. Huge play now in the works for Energy.
It went down to 92 right there. That was so devastating for Hard. He could have made that a hero play. He could have gotten his team the Baron, and when this composition has Baron, it's hard to deal with. You have to split up if you're Energy at that point and be like, all right, how do we engage on these guys? We have to have our Maokai and Karma maybe get onto the Konami. It's a little bit more difficult, but now Energy have control. Energy get to group as five and push down one lane, and they don't have to worry too much about the split push of Froggen.
No, they don't. It's going to be, I think, a much easier now late game for Energy. As we watch this again,
they run out at about 3,000 HP. Quas doesn't get the shield, so he's not able to chase over. Goes down to 2,000, and that's when Hard jumps in.
Yeah, he's got about Barrel Prime, 1,600, 1,300. Like, right here, you ult Santorin. You get the Baron down to about 1,000, and you try to get the rest of the burst across,
well, yeah,
right?
Keith is also just off on the other side. 800, 92, and then there was a 9 as well.
And Hard was sitting there animating. So, actually, I take it back. Hard actually cast the ulti at about the right time.
Yeah.
Because if Santorin hadn't smited, it would have knocked him out of smite range when Baron itself was in smite range. The two different versions of the word range in that sentence. But yeah, the smite came in early. Extra damage came across as the rest of Energy was around. And so no ancillary damage came through from the Team Echo Fox. And
yeah. Keith's positioning was a little strange in that fight as well. They were chasing off to the left side, and Keith is on the right side not getting any damage off. He's too afraid of just Quas, because they didn't have Santorin there, and they didn't have Kiwi Kid there. So you're worried about the Lucian, the Victor, I guess, a little bit. a lot. And also, Quas was rooting you, but Quas wasn't going to be that threat on you because he's focusing KFO. I feel like Keith could have done more in that fight, or even just walk up behind them and go after the two people in the Baron pit.
Right, yeah. Just fight Santorin, you know, help your teammate out, try to get the last hit across. Just imagine, like, primes the fourth crit, flashes in, like, smite this dog, and they smack it together. Like, that would have been some nice stuff. But a great flash in for Kiwi nearly takes down Froggen. That was a nice play by him, but now the chase is still on because Quas is here, and Froggen says, sorry, buddy, I can't help you with this one. KFO left alone, and he's KO'd. Santorin getting the kill, 2-0-9 for himself. Froggen just only getting back into the mid lane, and Echo Fox are just bleeding kills now, golden objectives as well. 7 turrets, 4 energy up by pretty much every metric that matters.
Yep. Every objective, the Baron, the turrets.
And what's funny is, except for top lane, Echo Fox are up in farm on all 5 members. Just slightly. They have slightly more.
That's true.
Individual minion and monster kills.
And it's just barely, too. It's like, yeah, basically chump change those 6 in the top lane.
Right. So which means they've both been able to sort of like access waves equally.
Yeah.
But clearly Energy doing much more with them, even with fewer tools, and that they don't have the Twist of Fate themselves.
Yeah, and when Energy group up, you know, they're sacrificing the farm in the side lane. Mm-hmm. They're being pushed in. So they lose a little bit here and there, and it adds up.
Yeah, and Echo Fox are clearing the waves away, but oh, they lost a turret. Energy doing pretty wonderfully right now. Next Drake is gonna be the Elder Dragon.
Yep.
And even Infernal Drake's not gonna save you, Echo Fox. Energy at the power of the clouds.
Obviously, 2 cloud drakes.
Yeah, causation. Causation, everybody, clearly. Team of 2 cloud drakes is winning. Infernal Drake is losing,
like,
obviously.
To be fair.
That's how stats work.
The Fox has the only in-combat Drake.
Yeah, that's true.
So when Energy actually engage, their drakes mean nothing. But right before that, you know,
yeah,
the positioning.
I hear Home Guard and TP Maokai's like movement speed. Thoughts?
Yes,
like,
yes, they do. They like it a lot. It's just all about getting in.
And once they get in, they're smashing because they're up in gold anyway.
Yeah. And I want to call out 2 players in this game because Froggen has all of the kills, right? And he's trying to pull his team, like you said, kicking and screaming. But Santorin has set his team up. He has 100% kill participation still. Action's been happening across the map, those picks on bottom, everything. He's always a part of these kills, and he's in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
And it's not just luck. He's such a good player now. He's really good at figuring out where to be on the map. And he's that assisting jungler. He's not so much that carry jungler. He's that assisting, get your team ahead jungler. And Energy have struggled with closing games out once he's set them up. And now we're seeing this game, they're kind of going through it a little bit more methodically. Baron, control Dragon, even if it's Cloud, just keep going back to it. And then push, get these inhibitors. And so far, it's been really good for Energy.
It really has been. So props to the new look team, switching up 4/5 of the roster before the split started. It's not been an easy road for them, certainly. 2-7 in matches, but looking to take game 1 in their second match of the split against Echo Fox. Looking for the top lane push right now. Quas shrugging off all the damage, takes a shield, and that's going to be an inhibitor turret going down. Bottom inhibitor itself is already dead. Froggen is still split pushing on the side of the map. They know that Echo Fox cannot fight with this at all, so inhibitor given up without much contest.
Well, it's also Froggen split pushing against the super minions, so it's going to take
only
him
only if there's someone there, right? They've got to get Baron buffed in the first place. Oh, the supers of
supers.
The inhib. Sorry, I misheard you.
It's the super minion, so
yeah, not the Baron.
Getting up here was very difficult for him. He's going to be able to get this, unless Santorin.
Yeah,
ulti's
we'll
over.
See.
He checks it out.
Froggen says, there is a Rek'Sai near me, but he can finish it off.
Oh,
no!
He
at least pick one, Froggen! He gets it down. Now the red card, but he's got Ghost.
Pray?
Oh, saw it properly. Santorin takes the kill down. Honestly, misplays by Froggen, but hey, a good kill. It is a trade of inhibitors, at least. That's something, right? We're seeing actual good plays come out, and look at this. Actually, nice play by OQ. Just pops the Mercurial Scimitar for movement speed, catches up with Keith, makes him flash away. Nice, actually, proactive play by OQ there.
Yeah, especially since there's about to be Baron and Elder Drake. So if you can get those summoner spells out, if you can get the kill onto Froggen, then you really help your team out in securing these objectives.
Definitely agree. And yeah, not having a mid laner or an AD carry is going to make it easier to make things happen. Look at this damage output on the mid lane turret already. It gets dropped down already. And Energy now to make a little bit more happen as they will triple inhib Echo Fox right here, 36 minutes in. A clean walk out of the base. And that was Santorin getting the pick on a frog and making the play happen, landing that Max range Prey Seeker.
I have to keep my 100% kill participation. Nobody else do this.
Yeah, right?
I got to do it myself.
It's my kill. To be fair, if you got away, it still would have been 100%.
Yeah, it's true.
That's what KP...
Quasa TP to do
I
it.
I know, right? Scumbag Quas could have ruined the record. So far, a perfect scoreline for Santorin. Continuing to be probably the best player on energy at this point. I think it's
he's definitely the most consistent.
He's the most consistent. I think at this point, though, I would just call him the best player on the team because he's just done this well for this long. And we'll see if that can continue.
It's hard, too, to actually have these types of stats when you're on a team that's losing.
Right. Jungler is pretty team-dependent. AD carry offense as well, but... Yeah.
You lose a whole bunch of your map. You lose a whole bunch of what your lane is as a jungler
right.
when your laners start getting behind. So he's been doing a good job of setting them up and being able to stay in his jungle and stopping other people from living in there. But right now, trying to take a big jungle objective.
See what they can grab as they looked at Baron, but then turn right back around because...
They look for the fight. That's what they're doing, is they're using Baron as this baiting tool. We saw it even when the Baron was like 2,000 HP, 3,000 HP. Karma Shield, run off to the side. They have to stop KFO, though, because he might end the game.
He's trying to push on the bot side of the map. It's bottom inhibitor is now actually inhibitor advantage for Echo Fox as their own bot lane respawns. So, yeah, there's...
Now they're pinging onto it from Echo Fox's side to clear it out.
To make the base... I mean, they can make a base race play, right? You've got a Lich Bane, Twist of Fate with a Void Staff and a Death Cap, which both help you take turrets down. I feel legit see Echo Fox's game plan being win the base race. And I want to actually use that as now the lens I cast the game through.
They're going to go for Baron right now. KFO is still here. So if KFO keeps Santorin there, they just have to worry about the super minions and they have to worry about the other members of Fox.
They will lose a Nexus turret rapidly if no one shows up. There's four super minions on the Nexus right now. They're going to lose their base literally right now. Echo Fox, pull someone back on the map. Even the minions are out-rotating Echo Fox. This is honestly shameful. The turrets are all dying. Nothing happened to the bot side of the map. The ulti from Heart is used to try to keep them off the damage output.
Oh, boy. These are a little bit rough to clear out as well. Well, physical damage, not as effective against super minions because they have negative magic resistance.
Yeah.
So you really want to have
a lot of armor.
Magic damage dealers like Froggen or KFO.
But they're staying. Like, look where Froggen is. He's sitting in
side.
That brush the entire time. Hoping they can make the base race play. Energy smartly only taking Baron with three. They're leaving GBM inside the base. This is so smart by Energy. They know the only win condition for Echo Fox is the base race. And they'll take the slow Baron to make sure that they don't outright lose the game on an out rotation.
That was a Baron without a smite as well. Like Santorin is in
YOLO!
The bottom lane.
They're all defending
that was
the super minions.
That was a big risk.
Yes, but it was the right play because they saw Hard was clearing slowly these super minions. They know no one's around. Tidal Wave was the only chance. They pulled off once they saw Big, saw him walk away, said, okay, we can finish it. Games will be lost by not making the play that Energy did right there. By not saying the only way you win is this, we will overprotect it.
It's a risk too, and
yes,
I like that they took it.
But I think it was the best play, and it was the right play, and Energy succeed with it. You're right, there was always a chance that Baron got stolen. But the win condition for Echo Fox is shut down. The inhibitor is respawning. Like, I think right now, actually, there probably are no more. Yeah, there's no more super spawning. Inhibitor's back up, basically right now. And Energy are back onto a good map situation. 7,000 gold up.
Oh, yeah. And
no supers left.
Even if they get in a scenario where they get desperate, that Nexus turret is about 800 HP.
Yeah.
It's the only one left. You would have somebody be able to backdoor.
Yeah,
rather
would
easily.
Kill that in two auto attacks. So here we go. On to the triple inhib one more time as Echo Fox have been respawning. This one gonna go down, and they've got a Baron buff, and there's only one turret for defense. Echo Fox aren't exactly in a great spot. I would not give up the triple inhib. Here comes the play. Hard knocks in Santorin, but he's got a Guardian Angel. Plenty of tankiness for those dragons, but it's not really enough. OQ and GBM's Victor take him down, cross the front line, a flash wave from Froggen. KFO now attacked and assaulted and taken out. He never even got to pop the Zonya's Hourglass. OQ down to the back line, but gets sniped out, so at least one kill coming through. But they're on to the Nexus, and Energy cannot be stopped. I don't think they can, because
Pee-wee.
Damage coming across. They're trying to kill him off, but it's gonna be enough. Santorin, the last one alive, to win the game. Nicely done. Game one to Energy.
It's Santorin at the very end. Energy playing the macro game rather well against Echo Fox. Honestly, across the board, they looked really good there. That Maokai pick looked like it threw off Fox. It's like 6.12. I thought we were supposed to have a gentleman's agreement. No tanks, bro. that's not the rules that Energy were playing by.
Spring Split style coming out well. And yeah, honestly, a pretty heartening game for Energy. We saw several very smart plays. Like, I fanboyed over Victor AFK in base. But again, that was a very intelligent call to realize that was a play.
I tilted from the Twisted Fate out of vision of the Victor for like 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Froggen didn't do anything there. He didn't show himself because he thought that would cause pressure. But GBM is doing the same thing. Like, hey, I'll be able to answer it if it does happen.
Well, either way, a good win by Energy. They've got to do it one more time in the best of three, but there's a good chance they can. So for a breakdown of that game one win, let's